Captain's log, Mayday. We are pinned down by a security robot inside the alien base. Varet, our best fighter, is down and presumed dead. Shaylor and I are all alone without hope of reinforcement. The Lexington and the rest of the crew are far away at the planet where they're stalled trying to get the Ithic to evacuate. They will certainly all die if we can't get away from this robot and to a control center.
Captain Carol Moore and Lieutenant Talith Shaylor fired back at the security robot from the cover of the rubble they were hiding behind. But it was clear they were outmatched. Then Lieutenant Commander Tyrell Varet rose up from his lying position, as if from the dead, and fired directly into the robot's weak spot. He remembered where it was from his days working on such droids. The security robot exploded, and the threat was gone. Thanks for checking to see I was still alive, Varet said. I'm glad you're okay, Captain Moore said. That was a defense robot, Varet said. There will likely be more before we reach the control center. Let's hope not, Carol Moore said. She was interrupted by Varet's expression. He was watching Shaylor, who was following the hand of one of the dead researchers. It was grasping for a wall panel. Shaylor went to it and found a computer terminal in it. However, there didn't seem to be any power running into it. Moore hurried to it and pulled off a panel below the computer, locating the wiring. She went about fixing it. Varet watched over her shoulder, correcting every mistake and describing everything he would do differently. Soon, the computer screen came to life. This left them with another problem. The buttons had symbols they were entirely unfamiliar with. Some of the buttons weren't even below the screen, but were to the sides and above it. Where they would begin, they had no idea. Move, Shaylor insisted, and the others backed away. Shaylor looked over the terminal carefully. He recognized some of the symbols from the patterns he had seen on the walls and floors, but that wasn't what interested him. What really caught his attention was something on the screen. He tapped the plastic screen a couple times, pressing through a couple menus until he reached a drawn set of lines and angles. It didn't seem to make much sense until Shaylor blurted, "It's a map." "Oh," Moore and Varet exclaimed. "We're here," Shaylor said, pointing at a point on the map. The other two nodded. They were trying to make out details on the map, but to their engineering minds it looked like wiring. Shaylor could make out the details easily, and couldn't understand why it was so hard for the others. "That's the nearest control center. We need to go there." "There's more than one?" Captain Moore asked. Shaylor rolled his eyes. "Yeah, there's one here, here, and here." "Right, of course," Captain Moore said. Shaylor ignored her. He continued to stare at the screen. "So, we should go," Varet said. Shaylor responded, "Wait, I'm figuring out the best route." They stood there in silence a few moments. Moore had out her phaser in case more of the security droids came out. Shaylor at last broke the silence as he pointed at the screen. "We'll take this route." He pulled back his hand and kept staring at the screen. "Okay, then let's go," Varet said. "Not yet," Shaylor responded. "I'm memorizing the path."
Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Lexington. Its mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no one has gone before.
The people of the village were now gathered around Commander Blackwood and his two human crew members. They were suspicious of their motives, and the statement that their planet was doomed. One of them, a lanky Ithic, who was introduced as Minister of Astronomy, claimed that they were in no danger. "When our ancestors were nearly wiped out by the Great Fireball, they saw evidence of it. Now look and see. Nothing to behold." There was a discoloration on the horizon in the direction of the radiation plume. It did appear like a natural aurora borealis, but it was visible, and Nemec began to wonder if the minister was actually seeing anything at all. Looking him over, she noticed that he wasn't looking anyone directly in the eyes, but rather than debating him directly on this point, she asked him to tell her about a cluster of stars she had looked up on scans while they were coming in that would be visible at another time of year, but were not visible now. The old ithic looked in the direction they would be and said that he could see them clearly. She asked about a nebula that would be visible at another time, and he claimed to see that as well. The people groaned, beginning to understand. Another ithic stepped in, the Minister of Philosophy, shouting that the others should not listen to the invaders. "They are nothing but the figments of our collective imaginations," she shouted. "Be not swayed by them, but shelter your minds from their lies." "What are you talking about?" Dr. Jatan said, losing his temper. "Could I touch any of you if I was a figment of your imagination?" He said this as he laid a hand on the mayor, who nodded his head as if to say, "He has a point." "Do not let him poison your mind, mayor," the Minister of Philosophy said. "We can feel these figments because of our superior minds, which can create matter out of the very air." The mayor considered, then said to Jatan, "She has a point. Can you counter that?" That's when Lieutenant Nemec asked Commander Blackwood, "Do we really need to save these f***ing people?" Moore, Shaylor, and Verrett finally made it to the door of the control room. Captain Moore reached for the door, but Shaylor, who was obsessing over every detail they came across, stopped her. He had noticed a code on the door, which implied there was a combination lock on it. Pulling out his tricorder, he scanned it, and found traces of gas inside. Moore asked what it was. "With traces of gas held inside the door? I'd say it's probably trapped, wouldn't you?" Shaylor said snarkily. "Ideas?" Moore asked. "I can try to get past the trap," Verrett said. "Right, I'll help," Moore said, and the two of them searched for a part of the door they could wedge off. While they did this, Shaylor looked over the coded pad, considering for a moment, then said, "Or we could enter the code." He brushed his hand across the screens, bringing up the symbols they had come across along the way. He had memorized each one in order, and was confident when he pressed the entrance button that the doors would open without the trap going off, and it did just that. They moved into the control room and began looking over everything. There were dozens of controls, the types of machinery they were used to, but not organized in the same way. They would have to figure out what everything was before they could use it. Captain Moore called the Lexington and told Tichelle that they had entered the command center. Tichelle then informed her about the progress, or lack of progress, of the evacuation. "Well, make sure we have accommodations ready for any of them that decide to beam up," Captain Moore said before signing off. Tichelle opened a line to Lieutenant Huerta, who was preparing the accommodations the captain was speaking of. "We've got places to sit, but no one's going to be able to lie down, it'll be so cramped," Huerta said. "There might not be as many as we'd hoped," Tichelle said. "Oh, how many then?" Before Tichelle could answer, a hail came from Abyss Station. Tichelle abruptly cut the line with Huerta and told the secondary comm officer on screen. Dr. Tala appeared on the screen, and she began speaking so immediately, it seemed she was already talking when the screen came on. "Have the Ithic people been evacuated yet?" "No," Tichelle informed her. "Our first officer is having difficulty reasoning with them." Tala's eyebrow raised. "The first officer? Shouldn't the captain be in charge of that?" Tichelle noticed an urgency in the doctor's voice that one didn't often hear in Vulcans. It was subtle, something only a fellow Vulcan would recognize. She responded, "Their skill sets are best matched to the missions they have." "Okay, okay," Tala interrupted impatiently. Now Tichelle raised an eyebrow. "They do not have much time," Tala said. "Get as many of them off the planet as you can." "We will," Tichelle responded. "And the captain is working with our science and engineering officers to gain control of the black hole to turn it again." "They got to the control center?" Tala asked. She looked genuinely surprised, or disturbed. "That is correct," Tichelle said. "Keep me informed," Tala said, turning off her image before her last word was finished. Tichelle sat back in the captain's chair, contemplating what she had just witnessed. "Fascinating," she said. Then she told the acting science officer that they were going to do some more scans of the system. Blackwood was beginning to wonder if convincing the Ithic villagers was going to be possible when a couple of them stepped out of the crowd and spoke up in favor of leaving. They brought up topics specific to the individuals that Blackwood and his crew would not know about. Through this method, they began to get through to their fellow villagers, and even the mayor, despite his Minister of Philosophy continuing to advise against trust. Nemec, who had paid close attention to the words being used, had a grasp on the subtleties of how to speak, and she spoke directly in their tongue without using the universal translator. This impressed the mayor and pushed him over the top, so he agreed to go with them. With his agreement, everyone decided to go, although there was one who was the most concerned about leaving, the Minister of Biology. "We can't let all the animals of our world die," he said. "They must be preserved. How many animals are there, do you estimate?" The minister could not say exactly, but he estimated approximately 38 different species. Blackwood looked in the sky in the direction of the radiation. "There isn't time," he said. There would barely be enough time to beam everyone aboard the Lexington. But when Jotun saw that this made some of them hesitate once again, he said, "If we can get a sample of each species, I can use their DNA to repopulate the species." The initials of DNA didn't translate, but the concept of repopulating the species did. So the minister was satisfied, and he set out to showing Dr. Jotun where they could find the majority of the different species. While Commander Blackwood and the others evacuated the planet, Captain Moore and her crew figured out the control center. Both took a bit of time. Figuring out the controls of the station took surprisingly longer than expected. They began with basic functions, finding cameras and sensors throughout the base, how to open and close doors remotely, and even how to operate more of the sentry robots, like the one they had fought earlier. The base had clearly been operated by an ancient and powerful alien race, and there would be plenty to research over time. But for now, they wanted to figure out what it was there for, and Science Officer Shaylor was shocked when he figured it out. Captain Moore recognized the fearful expression on Shaylor's face, so she asked him what it was. "This starbase is designed to create and manipulate a wormhole," he said. "It can also sustain anything inside it." Moore waited a moment before asking, "Meaning?" Shaylor pointed out the viewscreen toward the center of the solar system as he said, "Meaning this station can be used to transport that black hole to anywhere, destroying any star system it is sent to." After beaming aboard the Ithaca and gathering samples of all the animal species, the Lexington sped away from the planet and returned to the Federation station. Blackwood and Nemec were in the conference room waiting for Dr. Talah to join them, where they would be determining where the Ithaca refugees would be taken. Blackwood and Nemec were chuckling over how difficult it had been to convince people to save their own lives. They spoke pleasantly and remembered earlier days as trainees and on other ships, and finally Blackwood wondered why Talah hadn't joined them yet. It shouldn't take this long to go from the transporter room to the conference room. He called the transporter room, but there was no response. He tried again, but there was still no response. He then called Chief of Security Huerta and asked her to send somebody to the transporter. The response came back soon after from one of the security people who had gone to check. "Sir, the transporter chief is unconscious. She's been hit with a phaser on stun." Almost at that same moment, another message came in from Tichelle on the bridge. "Commander, someone is launching the other shuttle out of the landing bay." Blackwood was confused. Why would Talah do this? He had his communications officer with him, so he had her patched through to the shuttle. The conference room screen lit up with Talah's face in the foreground, and two Ithacs behind her. Looking closely at them, Blackwood recognized them as the two Ithacs who had convinced the others to evacuate the planet. Before he could say anything, Dr. Talah spoke. "We require the use of your shuttle, Commander. Your crew on the station can return it when they leave the station." "What the fuck are you doing?" Nemec asked. Blackwood was about to scold her for her use of the colorful metaphors again, but then realized that this was the perfect use of it. "Starfleet will be too reticent to use the base for its fullest capacity," Talah said. "We can rid ourselves of the Klingon threat and protect ourselves from any other enemy that might endanger us." "What the hell is she talking about?" Blackwood asked. "We should get to the bridge," Nemec said. Blackwood called Helmswoman Tichelle, ordering her to follow the shuttle, and they rushed to the bridge. Upon arrival, Nemec hurried right to her station and tried to reach the captain. There was too much interference from the space station's heavy structure. Blackwood asked a question to everyone in the room. "Does anyone know what Talah could be talking about in regard to using that device to kill Klingons?" Vacating the captain's chair, Lieutenant Tichelle said, "Not enough information yet, Captain. But I have a theory on why Dr. Talah is acting so erratic. We detected a high concentration of Trillium-D radiation spewing from the black hole. Vulcan physiology is susceptible to this exact type of radiation, it can interfere with logic and increase paranoid thoughts. Why isn't it affecting you? Blackwood asked. I have not been exposed to it for long enough, but if I continue to remain in this system very long, it might affect me. Are you okay to drive? Yes, sir, Tichelle said. Then follow that shuttle. Tala and the two Ithics were hurrying toward the ancient alien structure. Tala saw another communication coming, so she turned it on. It was Lieutenant Nemec. What the fuck are you heads doing? Are you fucking out of your goddamn minds? You can't fucking blow up the fucking Klingons. You're going to start a goddamn war, you shit for brains. The Ithics looked confusedly at Tala. Is this another language? The universal translators you gave us are not interpreting. I believe this is an ancient Earth language. Ignore it and prepare to transport. Tractor beam's ready, sir, Tichelle said. Engage, Blackwood ordered. The tractor beam grabbed the shuttle just as it was heading into the iris of the alien station. And just as it did, Tala and the two Ithics beamed into the station itself. However, Blackwood and the others didn't realize this until the shuttle had gotten into the landing bay. By that time, they were well on their way. Captain Moore and her lieutenants were finishing their research on the control center when Varette noticed that the doors were being reported as opening and closing near the outside of the station. They must be coming in to help us, Moore said. They're moving fast, like they know where they're going, Shaylor observed. Could they be the robots? Varette asked. Weren't there cameras? Moore asked. Varette worked with the controls and found some of the monitors. Sure enough, Tala and the two Ithics marched into view. Who are they? Varette asked, annoyed. Moore identified Tala, but didn't know who the others were. They switched their route and headed in another direction. Shaylor theorized that they might be coming to talk with them, but turned down the wrong direction. We should go to them then, Moore said. Ah, crap, Varette said, and he pointed to a room ahead of Tala and the others. Two sentry robots were there, ready to ambush them. Find some way to call them, Moore ordered, but it was too late. They got to the door and it opened, and the robots stayed put. They began to move when they saw Tala, but upon seeing the Ithic, they shut down again. I think there's more to this species than meets the eye, Shaylor said. We should probably get back to Lexington to figure out the next move, Moore said. The others agreed, and they went for the door, but it was locked. Their attempts at unlocking it failed, and when Shaylor looked into the security monitor, he saw why as a chill ran down his spine. Tala and the Ithics were in another control room. One of them was looking into a monitor that had Moore, Shaylor, and Varette in it, and the other was connecting its finger to ports on the control board. They're not here to help us, Shaylor observed. As soon as they had learned the shuttle was empty, Blackwood ordered Huerta and a squad of security to board, and he flew them into the alien superstructure. Despite the fact that they had a way over, he wanted to know how they had been able to beam inside in case they needed to beam back. Tichelle told him she was still working on it, and their communication was interrupted by Dr. Jatan, who said it was urgent. I've been doing medical examinations of the Ithic that we rescued. Spit it out, doctor. We're in a hurry. It's hard to explain in a short time, but these beings are synthetic. Are you saying they're robots? Blackwood asked. Partially. They have nanomachines in their cells instead of mitochondria. They've been around for centuries, probably since before the supernova, but they're programmed to consistently forget their past. So none of them remember it. Blackwood got a thought. Could they be old enough to have been around when this structure was built? He asked. That's very likely, Dr. Jatan said. Moore and Varette were working at the door while Shaylor was studying the controls, watching what the others were doing in their control room. They're activating the station's systems, Shaylor said. Then, they're forming the wormhole. Moore's eyes grew wide. How long? She asked. At current speed, 3.42 minutes. We have to get that door open, Moore said, but she stopped herself, noticing something in one of the other monitors. Blackwood, Huerta, and a team of security were entering and heading down the corridor. In a different monitor, she saw the Ithic sending orders to the robots. Those robots started toward Blackwood and the others, and as they went, more robots activated and headed toward them. Moore picked up her hand communicator. Blackwood, can you read me? Blackwood's communicator fizzled, and Moore's voice faintly came through. He picked his up and opened it. Captain, it's great to hear. You're about to be attacked in both directions, Moore tried to say, but it was difficult to hear. Say again? Blackwood asked. Take cover! Moore shouted, but just then the room was covered in blast. Two of them hit security personnel, turning them into screaming shadows that faded away. Huerta and the rest took cover and returned fire. Blackwood pulled back further, trying to communicate with Moore. We have to stop Tala, he said. She's trying to use the station to destroy the entire Klingon systems. Oh, is that it? Maybe we just let him, said Varette, who wasn't too fond of Klingons. Time for a quick game note. Up to this point, we've been splitting the momentum between the two teams since they weren't in communication. Now that they were back in communication, they could each use one another's momentum again. Back to the game. Hearing the interference with the communicators gave a thought to Shaylor. He remembered that the reason for the interference was the neutronium structure. He said to Varette, Tyrol, should the architecture of this base be able to hold the neutronium superstructure? Why are you concerned with that? We need to get out of here and stop the— Just answer the damn question, Shaylor sighed. Varette looked quickly over the base schematics they had on one of their monitors and said, Yeah, I don't know how they do it. It has to be done with some energy fields, Shaylor said. Without the proper energy to hold it in place, the whole base crushes itself under its own weight, Varette finished. So we can stop what they're doing, Moore said. We would be sacrificing ourselves, Shaylor said. But yeah, they forgot to shut us out of that important part. Do it, Moore said immediately. Hold on, Varette said, hurrying to the door to try to get it open again. I'm a little less heroic than you are. Just then, Blackwood called Moore. They had lost a couple more security officers and were being pushed back by more robots that were pouring in. He didn't think he'd get through. Captain Moore told him to get his team off. They were about to make the whole station self-destruct. Just then, Huerta spotted one of her soldiers fall. Three robots were on him, ready to finish him off. Huerta flew into action, knocking into one to throw it off. She then jumped on the second and with her legs around its head, turned it to face the other robot. And it fired, destroying it. She then fired her two phasers into the robot she had just knocked into, then squeezed her legs together and jumped off the robot she was on, yanking off its head. She landed by her crew member, covering him. But though she was very capable of taking on robots, far too many of them were continuing to converge on them. Back in the control room, the time was ticking down. They were now under a minute, and Shaylor had to begin the process of turning off the power. Moore had a choice between helping Shaylor and helping Varette. She knew that destroying the station was more important than escape, so she helped Shaylor. She was glad she did, as the Ithaca had discovered what they were doing, and were creating countermeasures to stop them, on top of the countermeasures that had been in place already. They worked quickly and frantically, watching the time tick down. 30 seconds. Shaylor still had two protocols to get past. 20 seconds. While Moore was counteracting one of the Ithaca, the other got past her and set up another protocol in Shaylor's way. 10 seconds. Varette had to cut through a panel to reach an override at the door. 9 seconds. 8. 7. Shaylor got past one of the protocols and was working on the second, but he still had the new one. 6 seconds. 5. 4. Moore managed to lock out the Ithaca and found his protocol. 3 seconds. Varette cut open the panel and cut the wires. 2 seconds. Shaylor and Moore deleted the last protocol, and with 1 second left to go, the power flickered and died. They began hearing distant booms and crushing metal. Feeling their room rattle, Varette rewired the door, and it shot up. The small team ran out. The robots around Blackwood and Huerta scurried away, rushing fruitlessly to defend the base. Huerta gathered around her surviving troops and headed for the exit. Moore, Varette, and Shaylor were hurrying for the next exit, doing their best to remember the way. Shaylor was guiding them by following the path of the symbols he had memorized, and soon they reached the room where gravity was going haywire, and junk was flying everywhere. It was worse now, and debris was flying in every direction at top speed. Varette led, hopping onto a larger piece of debris that spun them in the direction they wanted to go. They were near the other side of the room when they were jumped on. Shaylor and Varette were attacked by the Ithaca, and Moore was grabbed by Tala. All six of them were swept up in a tornado of debris. They wrestled and punched, each melee twisting like a complex dance. Shaylor and the Ithaca on him were pummeled by debris that separated them. Shaylor flew clear of the gravity effect, but he slammed into a wall, knocking him unconscious. Varette, who was much more athletic, managed to twist head over heels in a somersault, gaining control over his Ithaca, until he was able to shove his face into oncoming debris, which was knocked clear of its body. Seeing his friend on the ground, Varette hurried to him. Carol Moore was tumbling on the largest chunk of debris that was spinning madly in a figure eight. Both she and Tala were growing dizzy, but as Moore could see in her eyes, Tala was completely mad and hardly affected by anything. Moore, who was growing nauseous from the spinning, remembered what she had learned in flight school, to focus on something that wasn't moving quite as much. That was Tala's face, but Moore didn't allow it to intimidate her. She heard the distant thudding growing closer. The base's self-destruct was catching up with them. The captain figured out where the closest thudding was, and she shifted her weight in that direction, throwing Tala with all her might. Tala got caught in the gravity in one direction, then another, like a kite caught in a windstorm. And suddenly, the roof collapsed on Tala. That entire section of the room balled up and crushed everything within it. The rest of the room was beginning to collapse as well. Moore turned toward the exit, but then an ashen face appeared in front of her, the Ithic that had beaten Shaylor. It was holding onto a piece of debris and flying full speed at Moore. Its momentum could knock her back into the crushing gravity of the room, killing them both. Just then, the Ithic evaporated in a red burst. Behind it was Blackwood, a phaser in one hand, and his other hand outstretched to her. She held out her hand, and he yanked her into the hall. There, Varette already had Shaylor, and they hurried out of the room. They rushed down the corridors as the building collapsed behind them. Huerta had already taken one shuttle, and they got into the second, Moore immediately taking the controls. She turned them toward the Lexington and sped as quickly as she could. The ground wrinkled up below them and shriveled into darkness. Moore was putting as much distance between them and the destruction as possible. The Lexington was growing in size before them. But suddenly, they felt the shuttle jolt. The increasing gravity had caught hold of them, and they began to pull backward. Moore didn't waste any time, calling to the Lexington. "We need you to beam us up," she shouted. "Oh, fuck!" she heard Nemec exclaim before reporting to Tichelle. Tichelle got on the line and told them they could only take two at a time because of the graviton interference. Both Moore and Blackwood pointed at the two Andorians at the same time and said, "You two!" Varette didn't argue, and he and Shaylor were beamed away. Moore and Blackwood stood, waiting to be beamed off. They felt the ship drifting backward and begin to keel. They began to feel the tingling sensation of being beamed, when suddenly the ship lurched and they were thrown against the wall. They tried to remain still so the Lexington could get a lock on them, but then the ship tumbled again and they fell to the ceiling, then the other wall, then the floor, then the ceiling again. The shuttle was rolling end over end toward the crushing mass and the black hole. They were nearing the event horizon, and the closer they came, the harder it would be for the Lexington to catch them. And of course, once they crossed, there would be no coming back. Moore got her bearings just enough to grab a chair, and she grabbed Blackwood with her other hand. She steadied them long enough for the beam to catch them, and the next thing they knew, they were on the floor of the transporter room. In front of her, Varette was at the controls. He called to the bridge. "We've got them. Now get us out of here." Captain Carol Moore dealt with the last effects of fear by losing herself in one of her many books. This time, it was hard to do that. And though she was looking at a page, she had hardly read any words. A chime came at the door, and she told whoever it was to come in. It was Harris Blackwood. "Good book?" he asked. Carol first tried to say it was, but then admitted that she'd barely read a word as Harris came in and sat down. "Some missions are harder to overcome in your head than others. You may need more time to recover than Shaylor." "How is he?" Carol asked. "Dr. Chetan says he'll make a full recovery." Moore nodded, but didn't look directly at her first officer. Harris knew how people's minds worked. He could have been a therapist had he not entered Starfleet, and he knew that nothing he could say would ease her mind at the present moment. Duty required he tell her something else. "You should probably see this," he said, bringing up an image on her computer. "Once we reported to Starfleet what that alien base was, they checked through all of their deep space probe scans. They found a few others just like it." "They're getting control over them, I assume," Carol said. "They're going to destroy the ones they can. No one should have that much power." "The ones they can?" she asked. Harris sighed. He pressed the screen at one point for it to zoom in on a specific spot. "One of these alien bases was found at the Klingon-Kazinti border." Carol immediately saw the problem. The Klingons were, of course, a very warring race, and the Kazinti had been a thorn in the side of the Federation on and off for many years. If either of them discovered it. "One problem at a time, Harris," Carol Moore said. "One problem at a time."